Okay, I'm going to try to give you guys a little crash course in how the lymphatic system and immunity and vaccinations work. Because, of course, vaccinations are going to be in the public conversation a lot in the near future. So, let's talk about B cells and T cells and what they're doing and try to get a metaphor that will lead us all the way through here. So, the lymphatic system, produces and develops these cells called B cells and T cells. They are two different types of lymphocytes, which is a type of white blood cell. Of course, all white blood cells originate in the bone marrow. So the bone marrow is really kind of part of the skeletal system and also part of the lymphatic system. Arguably, it's part of both. And lymphocytes and also macrophages are two of the types of white blood cells. We're going to focus on lymphocytes here. We'll talk a little bit about macrophages. So, for now, we are going to call T lymphocytes T cells, the same thing, and B lymphocytes B cells. So, what's the difference between the two of these and why are they called this? This figure just shows you that basically what makes a B lymphocyte a B lymphocyte is that it is not just produced, but it actually matures in the bone marrow, B for bone marrow. Okay. These only take direction from T cells. So, these can be very specific about their attacks, but they will not attack unless the T cell tells them what to do. T cells are different because T cells mature in the thymus. So I want you to think of the thymus as the place that they train the generals, perhaps West Point. Don't know. So T cells are the generals of the immune system army. They are the boss of the immune system army. If you take them out, like with what happens with HIV and AIDS, the rest of the army kind of flails, not knowing what to do. Okay, so let's start talking about what we call specific immunity. You're going to have to look at these figures in your textbook to really get them, but I will lead you through them for the first time in this little lecture. Okay, so let's meet the players here. And I'm going to try to simplify it for you and only make you learn the nouns that are really relevant. So we're going to be looking at this first picture first. Okay, so what I want to do is I want to develop what's called specific immunity. And specific immunity learns about a specific attacker with a specific flag antigen and not only launches an immune system response to that specific attacker and specific flag, but remembers how to defeat it quicker for the next time. Okay, so let's identify some of the players. Lymphocytes are the primary thing that we're going to be talking about here. B cells and T cells will recognize, then activate, then attack specific antigen molecules. So remember that an antigen is the flag. We are not going to attack our own flags. We can see them, but we don't launch an immune system response to them because they are ours. But if we run into a foreign cell with an antigen that looks different, perhaps from germ exposure, bacteria, virus, something, then the T cells, a specific type of T cell, but T cell is enough for us now, its job is to constantly be scanning for these foreign flags. And when it finds a foreign flag, and it's as sure as it can be that it is actually an invader, then the T cell is going to recognize this foreign antigen. And it's going to activate the immune response. The general is going to give the command to start launching an immune response. And among the things that happens with the immune response is that this is going to activate a B cell. It's also going to activate some macrophages, which are your big bruisers. And then these are the little poison squad that are going to go and take out specifics. We'll come back to that in just a minute. So, the T cells recognize the antigen and give the command, which is going to activate the B cells. So, we're going to come back to B cells because this is going to be important for talking about vaccination. So, now the B cell is activated. So, stick with me for a second and we're going to see what the B cell does when the T cell tells it what to do. When the B cell gets activated, yeah, okay, because the T cell told it what to do, what the B cell is going to do is two things. It is going to start going through cell division And it's going to make a bunch of these big blobby looking cells. These are called plasma cells, and their job is to make the missiles. They are going to make the antibodies. Antibodies are proteins that are specific to this antigen, and they can whoop up on that antigen. So they are going to make these antibodies. Those are the missiles that we're talking about. So think about the plasma cells as basically activating the missile factory. And then, importantly, they are also going to make a memory B cell that remembers this exposure. So, just looking at the math, we had one B cell, and now we've got two. And then this one's going to go through cell division, and then we're going to have more plasma cells and more antibodies and more memory cells. So, two important things have happened here. We activated missile factories, and we got ready to launch some more missile factories. Okay, so the memory B cells are going to remember that specific antigen on that specific germ for a quicker response the next time you get exposed to it. Okay, so this is building up your immune system. That's what it's doing. It says, I met it once. I launched an immune system response. I'm going to be able to do it faster the next time because when this antigen gets in, these antibodies are already there and prepared for it. I may not ever even feel sick the second or third time I get exposed to this specific antigen. Now, the important thing you need to know is that these antibodies are specific to that antigen. You are not going to have a chickenpox antibody that also works for the flu. That's not how it works. It's very, very specific. This missile will only target something that it basically has the flag for. Okay. So the other thing that happens is that during this process, this little guy right here, which I didn't teach you guys about before, it's a specific type of T cell called a cytotoxic T cell. That one also will go and find any foreign cell with that actual antigen in it, and it will actually specifically like poison it and cause it to go through cell death. So you kind of think about this as poisoning the invaders. It's like killing them off with poison. These are called cytotoxic T cells. And then your macrophages are just basically big bruisers that are going around looking for anything weird. But you're going to have more macrophages when the T cells say, hey, everybody alert, alert. The macrophages is not looking for the specific antigen. It's just going around and looking for anything weird. Okay. All right. So now, what does this do over time? Your specific immunity, because of this process, becomes more effective at fighting off pathogens with each exposure, unlike nonspecific defenses. Now, the only weird thing is that, of course, these guys are going through evolution and sometimes changing how their flags look slightly. And so sometimes you don't recognize them the next time. So, and that's basically them defending themselves from your defense systems. Okay, so last little tidbit, I want to rope this into talking about vaccinations and the different ways that this can be done. Okay, so we already talked about HIV and AIDS. The problem with HIV and AIDS is that human immunodeficiency virus actually takes out the generals because it actually specifically infects and kills off these helper T lymphocytes. It kills those off. And when you take out the generals, the rest of the army is really never told what to do. And when that occurs, you can get AIDS, which is acquired immunodeficiency syndrome, in which you can't really respond too much of anything because your generals were taken out, and you'll die of things that normally your immune system would have protected you from. Okay, so let's talk just briefly about vaccinations and disease rates, and let's talk about. So, when you look at this, is just from the Wall Street Journal, Battling Infectious Diseases of the 20th Century, the Impact of Vaccines. So, this one's kind of interesting. So, you can look up till 1963, I think that was when the measles vaccine was introduced. You can look at the number of measles rates in the different states until the vaccine was introduced. You can look at hepatitis A in the different states. Mumps vaccine was introduced way back here. Pertussis, which is whooping cough, polio, which is a nasty one, really deadly and caused paralysis and all kinds of things. Vaccine introduced, rubella, So you can look at what has happened in all of these different states. It's kind of interesting, and they're kind of interactive as well. But I want to teach you a little bit about how vaccines work and what they have to do with this process. So let's go back to here and talk about what they have to do with this process. So depending on how you look at it, there are like four or five different categories of vaccines. I've kind of put them together in different ways to make sure that it makes sense to you. So what you can do is you can say that I don't want chickenpox later. So you could actually give a weakened version of the living organism and then launch an immune system response to it, in which what would happen is I would give a weakened version of the antigens of chickenpox. The cell itself, that's actually a weakened live version. And then that will launch this immune system response, and I will make antibodies and memory B cells and all of that kind of stuff. And then what would happen is if I get exposed to the stronger version, next time I already have the antibodies, I already have the memory B cells, it's unlikely that I will actually contract the disease. None of these, by the way, are absolutely 100%. It just doesn't work that way. You are depending on your own immune system, and immune systems vary. So these, because they are living organisms, a weakened version of the whole germ, the whole virus, or the whole bacteria, you're giving a weakened version of it. Because they're living organisms, they of course need refrigeration. The vaccination does tend to last a very long time, and these are really tend to be very, very effective vaccines. But if you have a person who has a weakened immune system, sometimes their immune system is too weak to handle this live version. So, what kinds of vaccines that we have run into are live weakened, also called attenuated vaccines. MMR, which is measles, mumps, and rubella, and the chickenpox vaccine are those types of vaccines. So, live attenuated viruses, that's one of the things. Also, a whole bunch of them that you can see right there. All right, so that's one way you can do it. The other way you can do it is you can give a dead version of the organism. So, it's definitely not alive. Okay, doesn't need to be kept on ice because it doesn't need to be kept alive most of the time. You get a killed version of the germ. But remember, it really just responds to the flags. So as long as the flags are intact, you can still launch an immune system response. So as long as you can still see the antigen, you can launch an immune system response, and you can get the same thing here. So it's a killed form of the germ. They don't tend to last as long, or the immunoprotection doesn't last as long. So, a lot of times these will need boosters. So, these include vaccinations for hepatitis A, the flu shot, rabies. These are the inactivated or killed vaccines. Then there are a whole category called subunit vaccines, in which I don't give the whole organism at all. I just give a chunk of the organism, not a living organism, not a dead organism, just a piece of the organism. You can use a cell protein that's on the surface, you can use a sugar, you can use a toxin that the organism made, or you can use like the capsule that surrounds the whole organism. But you're not using the whole thing. So these are called subunit vaccines, and there's several different kinds of subunit vaccines, and here they kind of lumped them. So subunit, they just give a chunk of something from the organism, but not the whole organism. It's not alive, it's not dead, it's just a chunk of something from it. And this, as long as you can see the antigen, it will cause an immune system response. These work really well. They don't tend to cause as many problems with immunocompromised people because, of course, they are not organisms, either living or dead. They're just a chunk from the organism that will launch the immune system response. But they don't last as long as like the live ones either, so you may need a booster. Some examples of things that work this way are hepatitis B, human papillomavirus, whooping cough, diphtheria, and tetanus. With diphtheria and tetanus, you actually give the toxin that the organism makes, and then you launch an immune response to the toxin instead of the organism itself. So that's how a tetanus shot works. Okay, and then the new one that they're not that new. They've been working on them for 30 years. It's just that with the COVID damage that the COVID has done both to individuals, to economies, to everything. What we have done with most of the COVID vaccines, the three that I know about as of today, are this new type of vaccine, which is, these are nucleic acid-based vaccines. So instead of giving a whole organism, alive or dead, or instead of giving a chunk that came from the organism, what they want to do is, stick with me, they want to give some genetic material from the organism that your cells will make into the antigen, okay? I want your cell to make me one of those spike proteins that is on the surface of COVID so that I never get exposed to COVID during this process. I don't get exposed to COVID, but I got the antigen to COVID because I actually made it. And then I launched an immune system response. So how does this work? So the three most likely COVID vaccines when I'm recording this today are what we call mRNA vaccines. And I don't know if you guys remember enough about protein synthesis to know that, of course, inside you, of course, you have your DNA inside your cell, and then you make an mRNA copy of like whatever gene that you wanted, and then you send it out to your own ribosomes, and then your ribosomes make the protein, right? But our ribosomes can make protein from any kind of mRNA. So what they did is they actually found the RNA that coded for those spike proteins on coronavirus. Now, not putting coronavirus in you, not putting the antigens for coronavirus in you, putting the RNA that codes for those antigens. And then what will happen is the ones that I know about are intramuscular injections. You inject it into your muscle, then it goes into your cells, and then you use your ribosomes inside your cells, to make the protein that was coded for in this antigen. And then you actually transport the protein outside the cell, and then you've got the antigens that are in your body. When the antigens are in your body, regardless of the fact that you made them, you will actually launch this immune system response to you. Okay, so this is what they are working on, and this is what the Pfizer one and the other two are mRNA vaccines, as far as I know. So these are the newest. All of these are still in the research phase. Right now, they just got approved for emergency use. And they are specifically using the genetic material from an organism without actually using the organism itself. So they're using DNA or RNA from the organism to make my human cells produce the antigen, and then the antigen will launch an immune system response. These are, once we know how to make them, it's very quick to develop this vaccine. It's not very hard to make an mRNA transcript if you know the sequence. And by the way, China gave us the sequence back in January of 2020 when they first figured it out. And then a whole bunch of people started working on these mRNA vaccines. So DNA vaccines exist, but again, these are still in the research phases for Zika virus, for avian flu, for the 2003 SARS-CoV virus. And then we're working on mRNA vaccines for SARS-CoV-2, which is COVID-19 that we're dealing with right now. Okay, so that's it for lymphatic system.